exactly what he picks up as we hop into champion select, and already the Zyra has been taken off the board by Jhinair. We'll see exactly what Kongdoo are going to focus on.
Bans against Kongdoo are always interesting to track. The only champion that they've really shown multiple great strategies around is Graves jungle, which is a pretty frequent ban or first pick away if you're on the red side. So we'll see if they're able to nab that one.
Already the changes are showing here, with Lucian being the first ban away from Teddy. Don't want to give him someone who is powerful at every stage of the game, especially now with how much more smooth he is moving into the late game.
And it's just cool that such a fluidity buff, because you know, you can remember nerfs in the past where things felt bad. Where you're like, I remember when Zed was first changed his shadow speed, you're like, this champion, I can't even play it.
And yeah, but it's exactly the same type of change,
right? And now you watch YouTube videos of original Zed, and you're like, wow, that was really fast. So the fluidity changes and what it's meant for Lucian, specifically the combos in the late game, Deft was pulling off some great stuff. Yesterday, Bang as well, so could be a pretty frequent ban, especially with the ban pool being pretty fluid. We haven't really seen a champion banned every game so far. We've seen many champions pop in and out of the Rift. There hasn't been a consensus must ban, but we're still very early in the 7.5 meta that we expect to extend all the way to playoffs. Then we might see 7.6, which is now live. As looking at the picks, we had a feeling Graze wouldn't get over to Kongdoo one way or the other. It's going to be a safe first pick for Raze.
Yeah, so Raze is going to lock that one down. And of course, Graves definitely a coveted pick even on this patch. As this is an interesting one, the hover of the Varus. I mean, Varus we've been seeing still have a relatively massive priority, but the build has completely changed. How he works definitely has changed. A little bit closer he has to be in order to really get that damage off, but it shows that when he does get there, my god, he can do some work.
One of the amusing things is that both Kongdoo and MVP, actually, when they were coming through Challenger and making it into Summer, the big story for them, going through Spring, sorry, well, the big story for both those teams as they've come into this, they were both big Varus teams. So Kongdoo actually, when they were last in LCK and in Challenger, have had the flex Varus. Of course, it was mostly mid lane Varus, as AD carry Varus is a much later thing, but they've always had priority on the champion. We've seen great results from it situationally. We saw three games from Maha on the Varus against KT in that series they won. Yeah. So as you say, build has changed. We don't even know for sure that it won't be Essence Reaver Hurricane as on 7.4. Right at the end, when clearly players have been playing on the live patch, we saw the return of that build that we saw in the first couple of weeks of LCK.
But yeah, exactly.
With more Blade of the Ruined King and with the Blade of the Ruined King buffs, it is heavily expected to be Blade of the Ruined King. And hell, it might even be a Blade of the Ruined King Ash again, Atlas.
Well, that's exactly what we saw yesterday, which is very exciting. Notably, of course, Blade of the Ruined King pretty ridiculous at the moment.
So we're looking at probably support here for Kongdoo, unless they want to pick up a top laner. Rumble and Nautilus gone, and everything else is pretty much on the same level, so you don't have a must snatch away, so it's going to be support to match, and we start to look at potential second round picks, because Kuzan's Vladimir is a champion that's available.
Well, may not be, as a couple of bans are available here for Kongdoo if they'd like to get rid of that one.
Edge hasn't played a game of it this season yet, but what we often see when no solo lanes are taken is you take the safe blind pick mid laner as the first pick of the second round and then counter pick top. Yeah. So Vladimir is going to be that first ban, so clearly Edge is not willing to play it.
Homework has been done.
Orianna and Ryze seem to be the ones that Edge is most comfortable on, so expect that to be one of the potential first picks here for Kongdoo Monster.
Yeah, it wouldn't be surprising to see that Orianna banned away as the second option here. Syndra is going to be the first. Haven't seen her get through to this last phase of picks too many times.
A little bit on, I believe, the first day of 7.5 at the Gangnam Stadium. We saw a bit of Mickey playing Syndra.
Yeah.
So still the Syndra specialists are picking it up. And interesting, a Kennen ban. The on-hit Kennen. Really something that Sowon's been playing. I believe he's played a single game of it in competitive. I may be misspeaking on that. But he had been playing it in his solo queue. So still a decent ban. We saw a lot of Fizz bans yesterday, you remember, Atlas.
A bit of the on-hit Fizz, a possibility.
Trinity Force Echo as well saw some play. So the answers to Rumble were relevant then, obviously less relevant with it banned. Taliyah means that Ryze and Orianna, again, are the most staple blind pick champions.
Could Edge potentially has been, just be the trade here.
And Ryze's, Edge's best champion has been Ryze in terms of performance, but Orianna won them a game that he hard carried against Jhinair last time out, so a lot of blind pick Orianna this week, and it continues.
Yeah, they're going to lock that one away. So he's only played Orianna three times compared to the Ryze's 10, but like you said, a little bit more dominance in that performance. The Jace is actually going to be picked up here. Could be going to So-1 or Kuzan. We'll see who's going
to pick
that one up.
So-1 is known first as an aggressive laner. Back when he first debuted in 2015 summer, I was told, this guy's a Riven God. And so you can understand
How many times do you hear that about top laners?
There's a lot of Riven Gods that struggle to make it into competitive because it turns out dominating lane on Riven doesn't necessarily make you good at teleports.
It's true. Thankfully, Huni did learn the error of his ways, as that is going to be the victor. So confirmed for the Jace towards the top side of the map, and a lot of damage, and a lot of long-range damage actually coming out of Jhin Air.
I mean, pressure draft. You know, this is all about sieging and wave clear in the mid lane from the victor. Not a lot of force. Well, Ash Arrow Malzahar has certainly some force as we look on the side of Kongdoo needing a top laner.
It's going to be the Gragas locked in here. So Roach going to be going a little bit more tanky, but does have the wave clear available. I do like the option.
Well, the only carry top laner that he's shown much proficiency with is the Camille, which obviously had to be banned early. So he went for the tank with the most early trading and the early sustain as well from Gragas. So it's the safest of tanks to choose in this particular environment with Nautilus banned, but doesn't necessarily inspire confidence. However, a good siege tool, anti-siege tool, is the explosive cast, specifically for bouncing someone like a Jace into the front line and being deleted. So.
And anti-siege is like exactly what they need against this composition as well, because there is so much push available to Jhin Air at the moment with all of the wave clear that they have in so many lanes.
And kind of the amusing thing for Kongdoo is they have the Gragas Orianna, which used to be, you know, back when we were casting together in LPL, the ultimate anti-synergy because explosive cast spits people out and the Shockwave wants to bring people in. But now, because you have the mini stun on the body slam, you can be a really good ball carrier because you're stunned for that 1 second of the Shockwave cast time, so it still can be relevant, but very strong wave clear on both sides means that don't necessarily sit too far forward. Get back in the chair, get comfortable, OGN Legion and you and I, Atlas, because this one could be a long one.
Although, I mean, we do have a Lee Sin coming out here, so could be an opportunity to capitalize on some of those pushing lanes.
It's Jhin Air. It's your first Jhin Air series. There's no silver lining. We're going long, boys.
Look, I'm always looking for a silver lining, Papa Smithy. That is me. My optimism cannot be cured. We've tried it before, but ladies and gentlemen, let's go to the riff for game number one. Looks like not too many enthusiastic fans in the audience at the moment.
I mean, that's not mince words. It's 5 p.m. on a Thursday with 9th versus 10th.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that people were being quiet. So we don't have that many fans here, Atlas. And we're in Korea where, you know, it's the land of the winners. We've had so many world champions here. Koreans like winners. They're not a big fan of losers. And unfortunately, these two teams only have 3 match wins between them. So even though Jhin Air have their pockets of loyal fans that have sat through many, many disappointing seasons, Kongdoo predictably still building up their fan base. Fan base in Overwatch actually looking pretty good, but the League of Legends success has been few and far between.
Unfortunately, not getting the spillover this time around. But the good news is one of these teams is going to be a winner today, Papa Smithy.
And maybe they'll both be winners in our hearts. Look at me. I can be glass half full,
well,
too.
Well, I know that we're both going to be winners because we're here commentating it together.
We could be here a long time.
And that's why it's better to stay positive.
I mean, Jhin Air have always been consistent in game time. They've always averaged over 40 minutes. 42, longest in the league, of course, this season. It used to be Samsung next to them, interestingly, whether they were at the bottom or the top of the table.
Look at this. Actually, a very aggressive start here from Jhin Air. Might be able to pressure them off this red buff, but it is being taken from the other side of the map. As Raze is going to walk straight in there. He's going to have to flash over this wall. Does. That's a big flash, but does make it to safety.
We've seen this strategy before, actually, giving the level 1 red buff over to the bot lane, specifically to Ash. This was against Bang. I forget who SK Telecom were playing on the day. It might have been BBQ Oliver's. But basically, they donated red buff level 1 and stole away or contested the enemy Raptors, in this case, the red buff, in order to set up a winning trades in the bot lane. Varus is a very strong laning champion versus Lulu, hard for Malzahar, only really gets relevant in the 2v2 at level 6. So just trying to accelerate Teddy, which, given the statistics, probably a good idea.
All eggs in the Teddy basket. I do like it as well. You're capitalizing on the fact that you do have the Malzahar, who's so fantastic at leashing any buff early.
I imagined a basket of teddy bears. It was adorable.
Tiny teddies? Like little bits.
No, not tiny teddies. We're not going full Oceanic just yet.
Not yet. Sorry, I'm just jumping.
We can say Australian now. We don't need to say Oceanic anymore. We're not on a Riot broadcast. Just Australia. I've never even been to New Zealand.
I have been to New Zealand, and they had tiny teddies.
Did
so,
they?
I'm sorry. It's still an Oceanic thing.
How many of the other things that Australians think about New Zealanders was actually true?
New Zealanders aren't silly enough to like Vegemite. Oh. Thank goodness.
They don't adore their Vegemite?
No, they don't.
They're not growing stronger every week? One person in
the
chat.
You call
me out.
Yeah, you call me out for starting too early, and then you just go fully deep on the Vegemite ad.
Yeah, I'm a hypocrite, Atlas.
I like it. It's one of my favorite qualities of yours. Well, Kuzan just clearing out this mini wave. Edge does have the push on him, though, which is certainly handy. Move around.
Because you have good pushing advantages on Jace, you can certainly be ganked. And Gragas, even early, pre-6, is a very strong strong lane to gank.
Well, you can see Sowan actually playing very far back here. Ray's playing with his life at the moment. He is trying to take down these Krogs. Does so successfully. There we are, sub 100 health. Punch gives up on his gank attempt, and we'll be having a look for some jungle camps, but there is no Gromp, no Wolves, and no blue buff.
And it was actually a super greedy clear from Raze. It was actually the jungle contest at level 1 steal into a full clear, because of course Graves can kite around the camps and make through with very few potions.
Well, there's the flash body slam here as Sowan does have to leap his way over to Punch. Knocks him away as well. Flashes very late and dodges the Sonic Wave. That was necessary. And he's going to save his own life, but that is a big summoner spell down. So still successful gank for Punch.
And they need to relieve that pressure because there are so many pushing lanes for Jinhao. The moment that Kuzan picks up his first Hextech upgrade, they could have 3 pushing lanes, which would be a big concern for Raze in the laning phase.
What the heck was that? Snowflower with the first blood solo kill off to the side.
A solo kill, not even an assist for Teddy comes through as... That was a 9th versus 10th occurrence right there as Gugu just died straight up.
That was hilarious. It was like the AD carries were having their own battle and Snowflower was like, yeah, I can take this guy because his friend is not paying any attention.
If you're wondering how that happened, Gugu miscalculated that Snowflower, you now max the Q on Malzahar, not the Voidlings after they were nerfed, and it was just more burst damage. He thought he could take that trade then back and clearly could not.
And Sol as well didn't recognize it either because that heal is still well and truly there. Possibly could have saved him, but didn't want to blow that summoner spell, and of course the miscalculation relatively evident.
Pushing lanes and now a solo kill in the bot lane is pretty concerning for Kongdoo Monster. I'd like to say this never happens, but it does sometimes happen.
I think it's fantastic. Goes back, grabs himself his Frostfang as well as a Ruby Crystal as the Chaos Storm.
Doinbee style.
Yeah, casually roaming around the mid lane. I am not surprised by this particular move. I've been casting Doinbee for quite some time. I've got Chaos Storm. Quickly, let's use it. Is efficient when it comes to cooldowns.
And I think a lot of people watch things like that and they're like, oh, he's silly, or why would he do that? But if you can just blow both the potions of your enemy or push the lane in before you get Hexcore upgrade, you're not going to be getting a kill, most likely. I mean, Raze is on Graves, so at level 6, you're not going to be getting a kill in mid lane with Raze not 6 either. So might as well just use it to push in. It's not going to be relevant till the next time it's up. We're going to see one of those invades. Remember, with the pushing lanes, these invades are safer.
Well, in goes Raze. Actually steals away the Gromp there as Punch is in a lot of trouble. Has to flash. Gets himself out. That is a big deal, especially for the ganking prowess that you do have with Flash up as a Lee Sin.
It's just spilling over into every lane. Now in bot lane, it's BF Sword versus Vamp Scepter. So Ash going to have a big pushing advantage over the Varus. We already saw Chaos Storm used to push in mid. Jace can, of course, push in top whenever he gets intel. The enemy jungle's on this side of the map, which he just got with Punch having to flash away. So 3 pushing lanes almost always is the victory in our 2017 meta. And for now at least, it's definitely going to be the first Mountain Drake as the snowball draft from Jhinair is working out against the 10th place team in the league.
Yeah, Snowflower definitely capitalizing as well as those Voidlings help tank up this Mountain Drake 7 minutes in. Smites that one away, does Raze. We'll head back to base. And one question I did want to ask you is, just looking at the Keystone Mastery here for Kuzan, how do you think about the Deathfire Touch now that it has been smacked around just a little bit on the Victor.
And it's one of those things where you hear, okay, it's been nerfed. And it has, but only for physical damage champions. The AP ratio actually wasn't adjusted at all.
Yeah.
It was just the AD ratio. So you might see Jhin, for example, looking towards something like the...
Warlord's Bloodlust.
Warlord's Bloodlust is definitely the one I've seen the most on Jhin. As Punch comes through with a cheeky blue buff steal. But
casual.
When it comes to the AP champions, why not? You know, still very much an option compared to the Thunderlords, so no change there for AP champions. It's the real takeaway message. Rumble and Victor very happy.
Yeah, still. Victor, of course, is known to mix it up, so Kuzan going for the more consistent damage route, utilizing the Deathfire Touch, and I like it, especially for late game damage.
And honestly, I think both those keystones have kind of fallen out of favor recently because we've seen a lot of mid laners swap to Storm Raider Surge.
Yeah.
A lot of champions in general. You see, Graves used to be Thunderlord's exclusive and now has gone to Storm Raiders because movement speed gets you more damage. And whether it's the auto attack or just another Q from the Victor or an E, for example, extra spell rotations in long extended skirmishes. Movement speed is often king, as we're now seeing a Jhin Air attempt to steal.
Yeah, we'll see whether they can actually get something done here. Piercing Arrow, lots of damage on a raise, and it does mean that Punch is able to secure it, but does take it away, I believe, unless Edge was able to lock that one down. Okay, Snowflower's got it, never mind. Was that a Malefic Vision steal?
I think it was just a Voidling auto attack. I didn't really catch it completely.
I didn't know you got that fed from getting First Blood on a Malzahar. Your Voidling's able to outsmite a blue buff.
I mean, we saw a Thresh steal Baron yesterday, Atlas.
That is true. Crazier things have most certainly happened. And no longer than 24 hours ago.
Here's a question for you. You know, we've all played a lot of games of solo queue, normal games, etc. What's the craziest Baron buff steal you've seen in a game?
Howling Gale.
Was it fully charged?
No. just the old quick shot. Let's just throw this over and see what happens. Blind as well.
Shout out Trevor. The two I've been a part of is Rumble single harpoon over the wall from the backside. The red side Rumble steal. And my favorite one ever was when I was playing Alistair, and my ultimate was down. I was level 9, and I walked past 5 people and single auto attacked it to death. I didn't have ultimate. It was literally just an auto attack.
I was hoping you were going to say you trampled it
to death. I just literally just slapped it as Alistair does. I felt pretty good after that.
You gave them the horns,
I
Papa
did.
Smithy. That's fantastic. Kuzan continuing to push things out. One CS in the lead. So far, mid lane, nothing to really talk about. As both are just clearing out the waves, but Kuzan with that upgraded hex core can be out. Oh, okay. Oh, no.
It's 9th versus 10th, Alice. We're
going to
miss some cannons. We're going to miss some cannons.
Oh, no.
No, no. You can't afford to get triggered about missed cannons. We've got plenty more coming here, Atlas.
It started so early. Oh, terrible. Well, Warrior Enchant actually done first here for Punch. Sol didn't know which way to juke and walked straight back into it as Snowflower. Now we'll be able to wander up. Doesn't quite get the ultimate range. And Sol's able to walk out.
I mean, Teddy's first priority there was just stopping the back. He wants to continue and be able to push in. Remember, he has Berserker Greaves and a lot of attack damage with the BF Sword Rush. So even if this just gets some turret damage, could be first brick here for Jhin Air. It's so low, I think, almost confirmed for sure. So while it wasn't really communicated to Snowflower to get in range for a Flash Ult, speaking of Flash Ults.
Yeah, Punch's just going to safeguard over. Really nice shockwave from Edge. Gives the ball over to the Lee Sin, and that's an easy kill. So evening it out, does Kongdoo. But first brick, like you said, goes over to Jhin Air immediately.
Still super clean stuff from Kongdoo and probably their strongest jungle and mid lane champions, respectively. Doesn't get them the objective. Raze can just walk over and casually steal the minion wave away. But Kongdoo are getting punished for allowing Jhin Air to get access to 3 pushing lanes, and specifically how bot lane has gone, where the buy timings have been heavily punished by Teddy. Predictably, Teddy's got a massive lead. You know, he's against what will soon be Beta Ruin King, but the thing about Ashe versus Varus, if the Varus has lane control, it's same as Illusion, any Blade of the Ruin King user, and you're forced to 2v2 lane, then okay, it's a terrible time. Your support leaves, you get bladed, your Ashe, you're very sad. If it's this situation where you just have boots 2 and flat attack damage, you just take turret and start roaming. So it's actually a pretty damn comfortable spot for Ashe.
Yeah, and speaking of Ashe, goes back, grabs a Zeal. Another dagger there as well. So probably looking towards the Hurricane. But we might see something like a Phantom Dancer. We saw it yesterday.
We did, but that was with a Blade of the Ruin King first for just a different type of build from Prey, who actually had 3 different builds in 3 games on the same champion.
all arguably relevant as well to how those games were going. Snowflower actually looking for a gank here towards the top side of the map. Just wants to clear out some vision now, understanding that Roach knew exactly what was up.
And Jace, 1v2 is what we get here, which actually, you know, we all remember Season 2, Season 3, and a very long patch of 1v2s. Jace 1v2 was actually always a thing because off the screen you instant cleared the backline with your accelerated shock blast. So despite being a squishy AD carry in many ways, he's safer. Speaking of safety, none here for Roach.
Yes, Snowflower actually just going to ult him straight up. The exhaust goes down. He's still tanking this turret. There's the flash as Roach tries to get something, but no. Teddy's going to be able to grab that kill punch. He's getting a red buff steal off the other side, but it's another turret going over to Jhin Air.
And the excitement is that this is the Jhin Air that's been taking games of some of the best teams, KT and MVP. Early aggression for a team known for stall, known for long game, is something they've been showing. And speaking of early aggression, they can even get some damage onto an inner turret, but they don't have a minion wave. We're seeing if the tempo advantage can be there. Seems slight advantage here for Kongdoo, but could be turned very quickly.
Yeah, everyone actually running out of minion waves, happening for Kongdoo on the bottom side of the map as well. Here is the minion wave now, as like you were talking about, just trying to clear out the minion wave with that accelerated shock blast, but immediately the inner turret falls on the top side, and it's going to be traded a little bit later there by Kongdoo. All of those minions now going to be eaten up by Sowan, who does have a decent advantage as far as that CS, and the Black Cleaver now under his belt.
So a lot of gold going over to both sides. Still a turret lead for Jhin Air, because they already had one down before the 2-for-2 exchange. They kill extra over to Jhin Air. 1,700 gold's not massive in the early game, but they're basically trying to take as many immediate structures, while specifically Kuzan is powering up on the Victor, and then they have a lot of pick tools to try and guarantee something like Baron. They definitely need to do a Baron by sheer force of will, forcing it down quickly, because they can't trade tank it. They have very, very low HP bars across the entire team. So a couple of Voidlings maybe, but everything else is just going to be brute force. So another Mountain Drake would actually set up what they want to do, which is put some aggressive wards around Baron to get a pick and then DPS it down as fast as possible.
Yeah, give Snowflower the ability to possibly have enough Voidlings to tank up the Baron until it's dead. But maybe not going to be a possibility, as Punch is hanging around the area. Does have Guga there with him. Snowflower gets a silence. Just need to replace some wards now as well, as Jhin Air do look like they really want to try and contest with this. Arrow flies forward. Edge clip from the side, as there's the safeguard to try and keep him alive. He gets out as there's the shockwave onto only Raze, but they secure the kill. Sol now trying to get his damage round from the side, but look at this. Punch frontlining beautifully. Snowflower is going to go down as Teddy gets polymorphed. He's going to get smacked apart as well, and a double kill comes in for Sol as Kuzan says, team, what was happening?
It just seemed like they went too far in, overextended into four members with almost no vision, and the turnaround was there. They couldn't one-shot Edge, and from there, shields and many other things lead to the turn. Speaking of turns, Kuzan's alive. So one's here. They're going to try and poke around, but they don't get the objective.
Yeah, Death Ray not going to be able to steal that one, and I'm just so surprised that Kuzan didn't walk down, because that could have been almost a triple kill with a well-placed Chaos Storm, but no, just doesn't get himself around there. So one's here as well, as Roach still struggling at the moment.
They do have a lot of turret damage. They want to get this as low as possible. Already have all the other outer turrets, but for now, Roach can hold strong.
Oh, this game all of a sudden extremely even. 400 gold in it. Teddy with his Hurricane. Looks like he's building towards what could be that Phantom Dancer next, wanting as much attack speed and movement speed as possible.
It's one of those games where evaluating the comps in the late game is actually pretty tricky, because Victor and Orianna both very strong in the late game.
Yeah.
Maybe slight advantage to Orianna with the utility. Jason late game falls off, but Gragas does as well. However, against a full damage lineup, the explosive cask, if it bounces three squishy people in, it basically wins a team fight straight up. So scaling's pretty similar between the two teams, so it's going to be more about who outthinks, outwards the opponent, which with 9th versus 10th, you never really know how to read that situation. It feels like on the day, either team could show us a level of performance they just haven't been able to in previous games, because it's not like these two teams are just terrible and the rest of the teams in the LCK are strong. It's just these two teams are not as good as all the superstars that have been put together in most of the other rosters, so they've just been a step behind. And when you're a step behind in standard lanes, the game snowballs quickly and the game is over.
Yeah,
very quickly. Despite Jhin Air being good at stalling, there's been a lot of games where they've just been artificially extending the game time. So outclassed they have been against some other teams, and that's why we're looking to see now, on a more level playing field, what are they both capable of.
Yeah, and it's going to be about who can orchestrate these fights effectively as well. I mean, both teams wanting to do different things. Jinair probably looking for that pick into snowball effect as far as a team fight goes, whereas Kongdoo Monster will be able to disrupt if they can find Jinair in a group. We'll see who's going to be able to actually get that one down. And you saw a massive fight for Vision towards the top side there. It's going to come down to these wards. See who can actually keep things working out.
So far, very defensive Vision for Jinair. And actually now offensive moves Kongdoo. There's a teleport coming in. It's going to come in looking for the turret dive here.
Yeah, look at the bottom lane as Snowflower is going to get caught by that Chains of Corruption. Teddy staying close as Roach will be able to body slam his way over. There's the explosive cast, but Teddy still able to get into a decent position. Raise here as well as Punch is going to get altered up and destroyed. They trade out Snowflower, but that's two kills already over to Jinair. Roach still tanking up a lot of damage, but tanky is exactly what he is. They should be able to actually get some priority on this turret, although the minion wave does fall down.
And it's two kills in a 4v5. Kongdoo unfortunately misjudged the situation. Snowfar still relevant despite being focused down with the ult killing Punch first, and then you have Graves galloping in with the extra movement speed from his keystone, and reactions from Jinair are good, and all this time, the meanwhile is very relevant because this might actually be a deleted turret from Sowon. There's actually only 18 minutes to the game. There's no home guards coming through after the recall, so they just get the turret.
Yeah. That W does a heck of a lot of damage to those turrets as well, so Sowon easily takes that one down. So Jinair now actually extending their lead. 2,200 gold, and I actually told a lie before Papa Smithy, it's going to be the Blade of the Ruined King, of course, as the theoretical second and a half item after the BF sword into Hurricane from Teddy.
Kind of stuck between a few different things, but yeah, you'd assume it's going to be Blade of the Ruined King second. And
I like that though. You know, it's what you used to do on champions like Tristana who wanted to siege early on. It's like build the BF sword for some baseline damage and then build attack speed.
Yeah, don't BF sword need into completed Zeal item into Hurricane is kind of a bit meandering because you get a lot of power in finishing recipes and
yeah,
you're kind of caught between three different identities. But as a three item build, I agree. It's not bad at all.
I think it's a cute way to try and work in the superpower that is the Blade of the Ruined King to Ashe, who needs a certain amount of things before she gets going.
Just sell that Doran's Blade for a non-magic mantle for a QSS later. Just have options.
I just want as many bits of recipes as possible.
And then, like, if you have a cheeky 3K, you finish them all, and the power spike is amazing.
Oh, yes! It's like having all the bits of a Trinity Force and the bits of other items as well. It's like, oh, wait until this all comes together.
So when you want a Sheen and a Sheen and a Phage real bad, and you have Sapphire Crystal and Longsword in your inventory, nothing else.
Feels like real bad, man. And then it's like, why didn't you build a Ruby Crystal instead of a Sapphire Crystal?
I just needed some mana.
In fact, Sapphire Crystals on anyone other than Ryze bother me so much because it's doing nothing as far as combat stats are concerned.
It reminds me of the time that it was an international tournament and a non-Korean support was building towards Zeke's Herald.
Yeah.
And had Glacial Shroud. Oh, it's Sowon gets altered. Not going to lead to anything. Had Glacial Shroud and double Amp Tome in his inventory, so couldn't fit in any control wards.
Oh,
and
no.
The Korean support was like, why is he trolling? Why is he holding the double Amp Tome?
Just build a revolver
exactly.
And move on.
Well, just don't build the double Amp Tome. Build one Amp Tome and two or three pink wards as they were at the time.
Bad. I like the double Amp Tome. Just turn it into something else, please.
They lost because of lack of vision, just to be clear.
Unsurprising. Well, that Voidling is looking very sad, moving towards Sol, who just shoots it in the face. Another dragon's going to be up in about 13 seconds.
What you noticed from the previous engage, where we saw Kongdoo try a 5v4 on top and lose, that Kongdoo's comp is actually way better kiting backwards than it is initiating. When you go for this Hurricane auto-attack Varus, he just wants to be sitting at the back shooting, which is difficult to do from far away, as Sol casually sidesteps the arrow.
Yep, so we wander to the side move.
Whichever team hard commits, especially if Jinair hard commits, I think Kongdoo can still win a fight, even though they're 2,000 gold behind.
Yeah, well, that was always the way with, you know, picks like the Gragas. Disengage, always fantastic, as Shock Blast is trying to soften up the members of Kongdoo Monster for this Infernal Drake going down very quickly. Is secured by Edge, and now Roach looking for a fight. Death Ray not going to do too much damage, as end of the line not showing Roach too much of a hard time.
Initiation in an open spot of the map, like mid lane, is almost impossible for Kongdoo. Not going to be in range for something like a explosive cast max range or the Chains of Corruption.
So yep.
While threatening, was never really going to lead to too much of an outcome. We go back to the farming phase. Soul's going to find a massive wave in the top lane.
Yeah, and despite the 2,000 gold lead for Jhin Air, it's looking like they don't have the confidence that they were showing in the early game to really try and take it to Kongdoo Monster. Kongdoo have been bullying them a little bit around the last two dragons and around these grouped up situations.
The problem is, as you look at the comp, if they hit an Ash Arrow, they have a go button. But if they don't, Malzahar will just die if he dives in alone without vision. So the only real go button is specifically hitting an Ash Arrow. So it's kind of all on the accuracy of Teddy with that specific ability to force it. So they don't have a tank. You know, it's Jace who wants to poke around. So initiation, despite the fact they're ahead in gold, is actually kind of tricky for Jhin Air to pull off.
Yeah, now all of those arrows that were flying at Seoul, not going to be as much of a big deal. The QSS has been completed. So this Varus a little bit more safe and at exactly the right time as well when these fights are going to start breaking out, especially around this Baron buff.
So this is a KT Rolster comp. We saw KT Rolster run a lot of comps very similar to Jhin Air's.
Yep. Pawn on lots Victor, of damage.
And then lots of damage, right? No tank. And I think a lot of people have criticized these comps, and they're certainly tough to play, but the way you win with them, which you don't often see, honestly, we do see this comp losing a lot more because execution heavy. The way you win with them is about the vision. You know, we come back to someone like Mata, warding up the enemy jungle, because hey, if you're face checking Jhin Air, they are super powerful. If you're getting to lanes the fastest by cutting through the enemy jungle because you have control wards around their red side jungle and thus can get to top lane and hit a turret faster, which is not relevant in this game, but this is an example, that's how you win with the comp. You need to be first to rotate, so you need to be first to have vision supremacy, because if you don't have vision supremacy, you can't flank teleport and you have to hit an Ash Arrow, you have nothing.
Wow, Shockwave actually used on the minion wave here as Edge was just, he was smelling a gank, and you saw Teddy actually lining up that arrow as well. Didn't throw it out, but nice disengage.
But this is the struggle. They don't have that vision supremacy, so they're only really swapping farms with the opponent. They're fast pushing a wave, it's going to the enemy, and they're not gaining any objectives, because right now they haven't sussed out how to get the vision they need to actually be able to push with this comp.
Yeah.
So with lack of force, with no teleport flanks, with only an Ash Arrow, Jhin Air, predictably, are going to have the game stalled out.
And it was something that we were prepared for, Pump Smithy, of course. Just Teddy, oh, volley, not going to be able to stop it, but at least does a little bit of damage. It's immediately healed in the fountain. Nicely done.
He's just shooting for the post-game damage dealt to champions, Graf.
Well, we know that Teddy's stats are real good.
He's got at least 127 damage.
Exactly, at least
100, right there.
120 extra damage on top of the easily above 12 that he's hit already. Given the fact that he's got couple of assists and a kill under his belt. I know he's been doing some damage to champions.
Yeah, you're pretty perceptive.
I know. That's why I'm a caster. You know, I see things. Deathray, not exactly living up to its name under Punch, who does have his Locket of the Iron Solari already completed. Giant's belt there as well. Very defensive build on the Lee Sin. No cheeky Hex Drinkers or more of Malmortius to be built up just yet.
Not really anything going on at all, Atlas. This is wave clear versus wave clear. No team is ready to pick. We might see a turret die. I guess we could cheer for that.
Woohoo! In fact, relatively soon, given the lack of health on that one there, Gromp is the priority here for Teddy. Wants to get more money. We know that he's good at getting money, as statistics have shown. The tower does indeed fall down. Minion wave dies, and I feel like this may be a rinse and repeat type situation for quite some time. Do you have any limericks that you know?
Limericks, you say?
Yeah,
not
limericks.
Really a limerick, man.
I have an Australian one, but it's not exactly the best limerick.
Is it broadcast friendly?
Yeah.
Let's go ahead. Let's hear your limerick.
You want to hear my limerick?
I do.
All right. There once was a man from Melbourne who got hit on the head with a wombat. When asked if it hurt, he said, "No, not a bit. You can do it again if you like."
Well, speaking
arrow's going to land, thank goodness. No more limericks as Edge just immediately cleanses that one off with his QSS. And it's not the exciting times that I was expecting. Back to the limericks.
Cool limerick, bro.
Thanks, man. My dad told me that one. You can tell. It's a dad limerick.
I've got some dad jokes to follow up on that one with.
Oh, really?
Future. I'll get there. Don't worry.
I got a few of those too, surprisingly.
But I can get away with them because I have Papa in the name.
Oh, no.
I'm hiding in plain sight, you know?
Yeah. I don't have any children, so I have no right at all.
I don't either, but I have a cool name, so I got that going for me.
All right, well, Teddy once again clearing out that top lane. And Kongdoo Monster are stacking just a little bit. Smokescreen goes over. There's a very cold sprinkler system. His Edge just seems to be oblivious to everything else other than the mid lane minion wave.
Sowon and Roach having a gay old time fighting in the bot lane, just shooting each other, but not leading to anything.
Yep. I've got bullets. You've got barrels. Oh, there's the flash. So on. Could have almost flashed short there. Get himself some extra distance, which would have been cool in a time where not many cool things have been happening other than minion waves dying.
Some people are into that, you know. I don't judge. You know, some people are just in to seeing minion waves die a lot. Monte Cristo, one of the big ones on no champion genocide, only minions dying.
If it's being done in a creative and cool way, I think is when the old Monte Cristo likes it.
It's true.
Maybe not when they're just generically running down lanes getting slaughtered. He doesn't like death for death's sake.
Has anyone ever realized that the minions are kind of trolls? They just int. They run down mid. They run down the lane. They never stop for anyone.
Nope.
They're just intentionally feeding the enemy, literally.
Well,
they were designed to. They're made of gold.
Hey, that's true. Why do they only have gold inside?
That's something really that was never been. I'm waiting for the League of Legends movie to get the real skinny on that one.
And have you seen their corpses? They just sink into the ground. Why does nobody else have this quicksand effect? Champions don't.
That's true. They stick around, but then they disappear.
Yeah, there is some intolerance going on here. Poor minions being treated differently. Oh, well, we'll go into that. I feel like that's more of a political discussion we can have later. There's Edge.
There's plenty of time for that, Alice.
Not very high on the old health bar is Edge in the mid lane. We'll have to go back to base. Might be an opportunity now for Jhin Air to do something.
Yeah, there seems to be a bit of downtime. Trying to get my report ready for the minions.
All right, yep.
Intentional feeding's not allowed. Riot have said very clearly.
I'm not going to report them. I feel like they're making a stand. They're intentionally feeding because they're not feeling like they're being treated like the other people on
the rest of sobriety as the Baron's getting low.
It's actually going to be taken here as Raze is going to be able to lock that one down. Roach as well, altered. So big tank removed now from the back. Lateral damage sneaks in between both Guga and Sol, so no damage. The Kongdoo monster just have to watch the big purple worm be taken down. Jhin Air are just going to head back to base, buy some more items, and get this siege happening in earnest.
And surprisingly, it wasn't the pick into Baron. We knew they had the Baron damage, but they saw the recalls. They had the wards to spot that. And very smart of them to make the first decisive move of about 20 minutes of the game time. Get the Baron, grow a gold. It's still not massive, still Kongdoo with a shot. We know how strong Kongdoo are if you dive into them. But out of nowhere, the game finally gets through its infancy phase, gets through its awkward teenage phase, and now the mid-game's come up, Atlas, so we might have some action.
And it was absolutely beautiful to watch as well from Jhin Air. I mean, we were talking about other things, but they watched Edge have to go back to base. They knew that a lot of that wave clear was now removed. They had to then move the rest of the Kongdoo members that could help with that wave clear towards that mid lane, meaning that no one was there to scout out that Baron. They knew they had the vision, and Jhin Air just did the math, knew what they were able to take. It's beautiful to see.
Yeah, and Kongdoo just caught off. You know, the game had reached such a lull that out of nowhere, instantly deleting of the Mountain Drake, and Jhin Air will even get a second mountain here. The first mountain helped with the Baron capture. This will help with turrets and no doubt the inevitable second Baron of the game.
Teddy's just being stubborn now, Papa Smithy.
How so?
He just never wants to finish that BF sword. He's like, BF sword is a completed item.
The interesting thing is he has a second Vamp Scepter now.
Yeah, so Mercurial Scimitar looks to be coming in, but that doesn't build out of a BF sword.
No.
That's pickaxe. So I'm bothered. That Infinity Edge is going to be quite late, if it is indeed what he's going to
do. I wonder
if
an AD carry's ever held onto a BF sword this long. Probably not. I mean, I guess if you were feeding and couldn't buy anything, but like, given how the game has gone, I don't know if we've ever seen a scenario like this where they're like, BF sword, that doesn't build into anything.
Never before seen in the history of the LCK, BF sword held for basically, what, first back until 32 minutes?
Now what I really want is a YouTube video.
That is a stat that we need to find.
No, now I really want a YouTube video that's like, you'll never believe what happened in the LCK. It's just 30 minutes of a BF sword in an inventory and a guy farming.
And it's just like the slow zoom on the item slot the entire time.
But if it's a slow zoom, if it's less than one time speed, it could be a very long video. It might violate some terms of service.
Well, it depends on like where you're getting this video from, because I've seen some very, very long videos.
True. And me too. They're often Jhin Air VODs.
Yeah.
When I'm doing the VOD review, those are the long videos
In fact, the longest one that I've seen is, in fact, an incredibly slowed down version of that Monsters, Inc. scene where Mike Wazowski nads himself on a pole.
Oh.
Yep. It goes for 2.5 hours.
I'm not going to explore that. I feel like that's not a conversations broadcast ready.
Yeah, how I even found that video, or how whoever showed me that video found it, is beyond me. But look, it exists on the internet somewhere. As there's the inside track being gained here by Jhin Air. That takes a lot of damage. That turret as Roach gets ulted. Can't actually engage anything, and another minion wave now to crash down. Meanwhile, So-1 on the top side of the map, and you can't leave a Jace on his own to take down these turrets, because he will do so. Punch! Just gets destroyed! There's the damage from Kuzanas once again. That is going to be a hula hoop to remove minions. Minion genocide is a relevant topic this game, Papa Smithy, because that has been needed quite a few times. Shock Blast, just to clear out the rest of these. So-1 does not want to give up on this turret.
Well, I'm so impressed with how decisive Jhin'Air have been. So-1, okay, you're probably not going to be able to finish off the turret just now. Just wait for the rest of your team. They're going to start coming up.
Yep, it's exactly what he's doing, though. And Sol actually tanks the second tick of the death ray damage. Not what you want. Very close with So-1 on that.
So much turret damage on this team.
It's huge. Teddy actually smashing them down as well. That's that BF sword that's been charging up in his inventory for so long.
I think you're being facetious on that one.
Just a little bit.
But this is the sort of pressure that Jhin'Air can apply with a Baron bar. That's why actually taking the Baron has led to a massive purse of gold on multiple members. They haven't quite cracked the base, but you know, another visit to top lane, and we'll see Jace being able to do that. And now Kongdoo make one mistake. Two members die. This game is probably going to be over from Jhin'Air at a very Jhin'Air pace. They average 42 minutes a game, and okay, most of those losses are them extending the game. But Jhin'Air so far, the moment that they've been given a real obvious invitation, like taking the Baron when Edge recalled, have been relatively decisive.
Yeah, but if you're going to look at a, like, I guess, gold graph for a Jhin'Air game, generally you're not going to have a gold graph that is this linear. This is Jhin'Air just slowly and incrementally building a lead until they decide to take down Kongdoo Monster. Whereas normally, I mean, things are fluctuating. They're making mistakes. Teams are finding their way in, things like that. This is a very controlled game from this team, who've just grabbed themselves another Mountain Drake, now moving back into Siege mode.
And that's why little things like Snowflower ulting Gragas on site are actually relevant, because that was a disengage Malzahar ult.
Yeah.
We don't normally talk about that as a mechanic, but it was literally the Gragas wants to come up and either stop the siege or pop someone in. Ulting him bought time for the rest of the team to back off and for Jace to get turret damage at top. So it wasn't even for a single objective. It actually won them a massive trade in terms of tempo on the map of getting turret damage and getting the allies away. So even something as small as that, that isn't going to win an MVP, won't even be in an MVP highlight video, was a good use of resources for Jhin'Air, who now find themselves 8,000 gold ahead, and Kongdoo, unfortunately, the position they found themselves in so often this season, really don't look like they know what to do.
Yeah, and it's this level of intelligent play that we don't expect out of, you know, 7 and 8 on that list. So
well, we got 9 and 10 today, Atlas.
Yes, 9 and 10, sorry.
7 and 8, maybe, you know, on a good day. To be fair, our 7th place team has 7 wins. And could still actually make the top 5.
We had. Oh, dear.
It's okay. I just have to correct it.
No, thank goodness.
Don't want to mislead the OGN Legion.
That is true. It's just two teams have disappeared. Just gone. No, Teddy just going to push up this minion wave. So-1 doing the same thing. And it is rinse and repeat. But my point was is that this is the type of forethought and intelligent play that you expect other teams in this league. So the Jhin'Air fans that have turned up will be pretty happy with how this game has been played out, even if it is against Kongdoo Monster, because a lot of these thought patterns are intelligent against any team. It doesn't even really matter.
And a lot of people are sitting at home wanting us to make, you know, the big hyperbolic statement, like Jhin'Air would win NALCS, you know, clip that out and be like, this guy doesn't know what he's talking about. Jhin'Air's not a bad team. If Jhin'Air went over to NA, I think they would be close to a playoff spot. And it'd be somewhere between 6 and 3, let's say. Hard to say, it'd be a very different regimen. Could they keep up the Korean training regimen and, for example, the scrim culture being different? Hard to say, but they are not a bad team by any means, just overshadowed by many better teams around this league, and a lot of talent where they just can't field rosters with Deft, Mato, and even that only goes so far as we learned yesterday. So Jhin'Air have had time, specifically recently, those wins over KT, the game win there, game win here and there, have looked pretty good, and against weaker opposition, they actually are taking the lead role we hoped given their recent form.
Well, Roach is actually looking to try and force something here. The flash comes out of Snowflower. The ultimate is going to be what's traded, but Roach not a huge cooldown on that one, so isn't going to be upset. But not finding the fight that they wanted could be a problem as So-1 continues to push up this bottom lane. And that teleport is available from the Jace. Still has the flash as well.
The boy's done it, Atlas. I got to cut you off. He's built a BF sword.
I know. 36 minutes was when it came in, so that's a 30-minute BF sword. It's a long time to be held, and we'll see whether that statistic actually does come out to be true, as that's 30 minutes is a long time to have that one BF sword.
Get on it, Twitter analysts.
Yeah, please, someone. This is the important news. We need to try and
We don't have spells yet anymore, sadly.
No! He's still there. He's just in the EOS. Yes,
yeah, that's the thing. We can't send the intro riot email and ask about that one.
Yep. Might be able to add him on Twitter.
Maybe Martin will be excited. I'll message to Fisher, but I need to know. Maybe that'll help us out.
Can we have the big news?
Hey, sometimes you have to backdoor yourself into the stats, you know? Like, you don't have the stats package, but you know someone that does.
There's an XPK reference here, I think. There's actually another thing to talk about is exactly what that BS ult was turned into. It's the triple lifesteal coming out from Teddy.
Frontline.
Wanting that massive siege.
It's kind of a frontline Ashe build without necessarily... You know, we see frontline Ashe from, say, Prey yesterday, but this is literally... If you take damage, you can lifesteal. If you try and poke around a turret, let's say command attack dissonance comes in and does 60% of the Ashe's health, pop into a minion wave, the next one, or even into a jungle camp,
yeah,
it's going to be basically full life. Because remember, it's a sheer amount of lifesteal, 15, I want to say it's about 45 to 50% lifesteal,
yep.
I forget exactly.
Close to that.
But remember, Hurricane Bolts also proc lifesteal on the secondary target, so literally.
100% lifesteal items almost.
Exactly. So, basically, that's full health very fast.
Yeah, very, very fast. And a Wraith Camp has a lot of extra little raptors.
And what does his team have? Damage. So he doesn't even need to worry about not having Infinity Edge or the highest damage build because he's got Jace, Graves, and the Victor to carry the load.
Yeah, and like we were talking about before, it's about taking down these turrets. It's exactly what Jhin's been able to do very, very well. He's been in the right positions, sneak in a little bit of time, and if you can kill a turret in that time, that's exactly what you need. And it shows. Two inhibitor turrets have been taken down. These inhibitors still sitting there. They're getting split pushed at.
Now, they're not playing three lanes, so that's one of our criticisms. For specifically the bottom teams is actually bringing up the minion waves in both lanes. And right now, no one's paying attention to top. So there's only two lanes from Jhin'er when it could be three lane pressure. And also, top turret, we remember, is very, very low. So that would be probably the highest priority lane to push in. We remember it being 20% HP about 4 or 5 minutes ago. So it's probably sitting around 50% with the... Turret regen is looking for a pick.
Yep, Punch is going to get picked off as well. That was a lot of health gone in a very short amount of time. Chaos Storm was used though. But that is a jungler down, and that means Jhin'er really want to take this Baron with double Mountain Drake and a heck of a lot of damage. They will be able to do so, especially without Roach there to try and disrupt. And see you later, Baron. This is number two for Jhin'er very easily. Just another day in the office for this team at the moment.
And a single pick into Baron on anyone other than Punch. There's still a bit of thought, because remember, no tank, still a chance that you're going to be able to turn on the squishy members of Jhin'er as they DPS down the Baron, but when it's on the smite, throw that out the window. Very easy claim. They're now finally pushing up this top lane minion wave to take down their first inhibitor of the game, and it feels like the cavalcade of objectives is coming just in a moment.
Yes. Well, it can't really be too much of a cavalcade. There's only three turrets and three inhibitors left. I don't know exactly what you mean. It's feeling like the beginning of the end here for Kongdoo Monster, who will need to make some massive readjustments for game number two.
Jhin'er just waiting for 42 minutes.
Not long to wait now. Even if they managed to get the ace and push on through, I think that 42 minutes is optimistic. These inhibitor turrets are... inhibitors taking a heck of a lot of damage, and so on is able to take his down. Was just... given a little bit more time than Kongdoo Monster probably would have liked to give him.
And Jhin'er decides to be clean. They decide they really want the Elder Dragon to take away any ambiguity. Four DPS dealers, and hell, a Malzahar too.
Yeah, I call him a DPS.
Elder Dragon is going to be a lot of damage. Even every tick of the E from the Malzahar applies the true damage. So periodic spells like the Equalizer and the Malefic Visions.
Yep.
In that way, are even more effective with the true damage burn as, well, Snowflower's got some actives, that's for sure.
Yeah, damn right he does. That is a silly amount of protection that he has available to him. Even a cleanse for the rest of his teammates.
And the only one he can fat finger is the Locket, which is probably fine.
Yep, absolutely. Even Redemption to a certain extent.
You have to cast it. I guess smart cast item, that would be another
fat finger. I smart cast all my items, Pop Smitty.
That's why you're so good.
It means that I can accidentally do stuff, and sometimes it's good.
But well, sometimes your brain don't work so good, so...
Yeah.
Just a smart cast by accident.
Yeah, I'm a play-by-play.
I like how you were, like, Southern and also finding League of Legends very hard.
Damn it,
in that
I was
same
saving
sentence.
I was saving my bad American accents for when you call me Achilles, but it didn't happen this time.
I got it on the mind. Not going to call you Achilles.
Damn it, I reminded him. Just wanted that moment. Kongdoo Monster having a real rough time trying to defend this one. Roach looking for that last-ditch effort fight, but they're not able to save this turret. And Teddy, given any time with that inhibitor, is able to take that one down. That's two dead. One final one remaining. Death rays flying through. Lots of poke damage available here for Jhin Air. They don't even need to start a fight. Because look at these health bars. Just looking at this team seems to be burning away that health. And that's all three inhibitors now gone.
The only time Kongdoo won and engaged when Jhin Air over-engaged on an Ash Arrow 20 minutes ago. They're not even looking to engage. They don't need to. Three inhibitors down. And even if there is a heroic defense from Kongdoo, I don't think they can keep their base up.
Yeah, Baron-empowered super minions as well. They hit super fast as these inhibitor turrets starting to fall. Look at the health bars evaporating. Roach cannot tank anything up. Sol has to flash himself out, but I'm not sure whether it's going to be enough. Ray's well and truly up in the faces of them. Roach lasts a long time, but eventually falls, and the turrets also get taken down. The Nexus falls now as well as Jhin Air take down Kongdoo now 1-0. In this series.
A bit of a slow cap for Jhin Air Greenwings. Slow clap, sorry. They actually closed out the game regardless of a bit of slowness in the first 20 minutes. When they finally got the Baron, they played order. That was very clean from this squad, who haven't shown that level of decisiveness, haven't been able to in many games, often found themselves behind, but went ahead after finally getting the Baron. Everything locked into place for Jhin Air Greenwings. They stuck the landing, and while it's only the first game, good chance of the Glad plane being able to come out for the third time only this season, because Kongdoo Monster, unfortunately, another game from them where it was decent at the start, there weren't any big gaping holes, and then they fall behind to a point, and it looks like they're never going to find a way back into the game.
Well, hopefully someone does find a duster, gets into that hangar, and that Glad plane can make its way out, because that's exactly what we did want to see from Jhin Air. We saw some shines of hope, signs of life from them against MVP, but this was just constant pressure.
But the scary thing is, kind of still looking for that proof of life from Kongdoo Monster. Unfortunately, they take to the rift, the mechanics are often fine, but when they start losing, they're not even going for the, well, we're 10,000 gold behind, why not make it happen? We saw, for example, Longju doing that recently. They're not even trying that. They're just kind of rolling over Atlas.
Yeah, and Roach, we saw, was, you know, he went for that flash play, he went for the ultimate to try and lock down Snowflower. They had some ideas of what they needed to do, but it seemed like even their composition didn't quite help them. They didn't quite understand what they needed to do to make that comp work, because we didn't have too many things to say that were negative about that one.
Yeah, not much to say here, unfortunately. Jhin Air, cleaner than you expect for 9th spot, but Kongdoo, same old story.
Yeah, it's very, very unfortunate. But of course, still early days. We'll see exactly whether or not Jhin Air or Kongdoo can come back in game number 2. Don't go anywhere after the break. We'll be back with game 2.